Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. If you could proceed to take your seats, we would like to begin commencing the program. I'd appreciate it if you would clear the aisles and start taking your seats. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kevin McCarty. I'm the insurance commissioner from the state of Florida, and I'm the chair of the International Committee for the National Association of Insurance Commissioners. And it is my privilege to be today's facilitator for the International Forum. I have been attending the forum for the NAIC for a number of years, and it seems like every year we say that this is a seminal year, this is a defining moment in history, and every year we're right, and this year is no different. As we look down on the number of issues that we will be discussing, whether it's global capital or group supervision, or is cybersecurity, which is a little scary to be thinking about, it's the NAIC has had a leadership role in all of these and continues to have an open and transparent dialogue on the issues of the day. And we are looking forward to the next 2 days of continuing that in the NAIC tradition. It is my main function today to introduce our speakers, and is therefore my great privilege and pleasure to introduce our first speaker, none other than the president of the NAIC. Monica Lindeen was first elected commissioner in securities and insurance and Montana state auditor in 2008, and was subsequently re-elected to a second term in November 2012. Monica makes it her mission to protect Montana securities and insurance consumers through education, fairness, and transparency. And she has been an advocate of transparency at the NAIC and on the global arena. Monica was elected president of the NAIC and is serving in that capacity through 2015. She is a strong advocate for states' rights and believes that the state-based regulatory system is superior and is serving our consumers and our markets well. In 2013, Monica received her Excellence in Consumer Advocacy Award presented by the NAIC Consumer Representatives. She received the honor in recognition of her work as a strong voice for consumer protection and her dedication in maintaining states' rights in insurance regulation. Monica began her career in public service representing a rural district in Montana House of Representatives. Due to her hard work in the legislature, she earned a reputation as a common sense moderate who could get things done, and we appreciate you bringing that to the NAIC. Prior to public service, Monica had a highly successful internet business, Montana Communications Network, one of the first Montana-based local internet providers. From earlier, she was also a faculty member at Billings in the English department and taught graduate assistant levels. It is my great pleasure to introduce our esteemed colleague and my dear friend, the president of the NAIC, the Honorable Monica Lindeen.
Well, good morning, everyone. It is my pleasure to welcome all of you to the NAIC's 9th Annual International Insurance Forum. I'm also thrilled to report that this marks our largest forum ever. We have with us regulators from nearly 20 jurisdictions, representing approximately 90% of global insurance premium. Not to mention dozens of attendees from consumer groups, industry, and academia. For the past 8 years, this forum has been an excellent opportunity to bring together the world's leaders in international insurance regulation and to take on collectively the challenges we all face. I expect this year will prove just as valuable to all of us. More than ever, we are seeing how developments in the global financial services marketplace impact the insurance sector. Moreover, we're seeing how international developments can impact individual jurisdictions, including the U.S. regulatory framework. These developments help shape this year's theme of international cooperation and harmonization of international insurance standards. We all look forward to hearing from the variety of speakers and panelists about their experiences and views. As a state insurance regulator, it's at the very core of our work in the U.S. to collaborate with our colleagues across all jurisdictions. In fact, U.S. state regulators are incredibly committed to provide leadership and engage in discussion on the varied range of global insurance issues and activities, both at the IIS and through bilateral and regional dialogues. In the United States, you can think of insurance regulation as BC and AD, or before the crisis and after Dodd-Frank. So in the world we live in now, AD has given rise to increased engagement with higher stakes to ensure global financial security. While international standards at the IIS and FSB are not binding on any jurisdiction, they do serve an important framework for regulators. When crafted carefully, this guidance can help ensure a degree of consistency in outcomes. Given the increasing globalization of the insurance sector and growth in developing markets, one of our goals as regulators and members of the IIS is to elevate the quality and effectiveness of insurance regulation around the globe. Equally important, however, is the development of international standards that take into consideration the variety of structural and legal differences around the globe. Successful standard setting must reflect the unique nature of the insurance market, and its supervision cannot result in disadvantaging one market relative to another. The issues on our agenda for the next 2 days, as you know, are complex and will require quite a bit of discussion to wade through in a thoughtful manner. Our moderators certainly have their jobs cut out for them. But to keep us all on track, I'd like to thank our MC and my good friend for the next 2 days, Florida Insurance Commissioner Kevin McCarty. As a past NAIC president and chair of the NAIC's International Relations Committee, Kevin has shown incredible leadership, not only here in the USA, but also around the world on global regulatory issues. Kevin also serves as one of the vice chairs of the executive committee and is a long-serving member of the technical committee at the IAIS. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you for your leadership, and thank you for your friendship. And thank you to all of our panelists and moderators for the work that you've already done in order to prepare for the next 2 days. And a very gracious thank you to all of our audience members for joining us in deliberating and discussing all these important issues. I'm certain that this will prove to be a valuable use of all of our time. So before we get started, just one last piece of information. I'd like to take a moment to remind everyone that there are members of the media with us and that the forum is being videotaped. So let's get going, shall we?
Our first panel this morning is on cybersecurity, protecting consumers from cyber threats and the growth of cyber insurance marketplace. And we are very pleased to have as our moderator none other than Sharon Clark. Got that one wrong too. It's you, right? No, it is Sharon Clark. Simple job, and he can't seem to do it. Follow a script. That's all you have to do, Kevin. I'd like to welcome our NAIC Vice President, our Commissioner of the great state of Kentucky, Sharon P. Clark. She is a veteran of the Kentucky government and was appointed as their commissioner in July of 2008 and was then again reappointed in 2012. Sharon was the first director of the DOI's Consumer Protection and Education Division, a position she held for 5 years. Under her leadership, the DOI hired its first ombudsman, added consumer education and outreach functions, and strengthened enforcement by expanding the number of consumer complaint investigators. And she has carried that history on through the NAIC activities and has been a leader in modernizing consumer protection at the NAIC. Sharon serves as the Kentucky Health Benefits Exchange Advisory Board during its inaugural year and continue as a board member. She is a member of the Kentucky Group Health Insurance Board and is vice president of the NAIC as a member of its executive committee. She's also a member of the Internal Administration Subcommittee. Sharon is a past chair of the NAIC Market Conduct and Consumer Affairs Committee and has done a great job in their modernization efforts. She's also been an officer in the zone, the Southeastern Zone, and is also past secretary of NIPR Board of Directors and interim chair of the Surplus Lines Multi-State Compliance Compact. Prior to her appointment, Commissioner Clark worked in the Kentucky Finance and Administration Cabinet. She's also held positions in the Kentucky House of Representatives, the Kentucky Public Service Commission, and the former Kentucky Workforce Development Cabinet. She certainly is a person of all seasons and has served the Kentucky government and the NAIC well. And it is our pleasure to introduce her as our moderator today. And the panelists can join, and Sharon will make those introductions.
Good morning. It's good to see everyone. If you watched the local news last night, we learned once again of another data breach involving an insurance company. So this panel discussion is certainly relevant to today and today's world. And speaking of today's world, we have an environment where criminals are attacking the internet for fun. We have employees who are selling company data. And if we can believe government intelligence agencies, even neighboring nation states are getting in on the action. The motivations for these attacks might be financial gain, it could be information gathering, politics, or terroristic activity. United States Federal Trade Commission identified identity theft as the number one complaint last year. Those most at risk are working adults, although in our recent healthcare data breaches, children's identifying information was also taken. And on a personal note, I can tell you this hit home in Kentucky. In one of the breaches, 50% of our population were breached with this. And that includes my 4 and 7-year-old grandchildren. So I certainly worry about their future and what could happen there. This is a growing concern globally. There are very few countries which are not exposed to this risk. So our panel today will speak to what the United States and Canada are doing to protect their consumers. I have the great pleasure in introducing our panelists. And to my immediate left is Ray Farmer, Director of the South Carolina Department of Insurance. He's also Vice Chair of the Cybersecurity Task Force at the NAIC. Julien Reid, to my far left, is the Senior Director of Financial Institutions Oversight in the Deposit Insurance for Quebec, Canada. Birny Birnbaum, who is sitting to Julien's right, is the Executive Director of the Center for Economic Justice, and he keeps U.S. regulators on our toes as one of the NAIC consumer representatives. And finally, we have Matthew Prevost, who is Vice President for Privacy and Technology for ACE Global. So please, would you join me in welcoming today's panel.
Well, good morning. My name is Ray Farmer, and I am the Director of the Department of Insurance in the state of South Carolina. But before I get started, there's one issue I do want to address. I know that most of you in the audience are looking at the stage now and looking at me and said, what is that guy of in his advanced status in life? What does he know about computers, and does he even embrace computer technology? Well, let me put your mind at ease. in my life, I have 4 desktop computers. I have 3 iPads. I carry 2 cell phones. My Apple Watch has been ordered, and I'll have it in a couple of weeks, and I'm looking forward to it. But I will tell you that every now and then, even I hit a snag. Yesterday, as I sat down to my office computer, I got that dreaded response when I tried to log on. It says, your password has expired. Please select an 8-character password and try again. Well, I did, but it didn't work. I chose Snow White and 7 Dwarfs. You got to think about that a minute. I'm sorry. And if I've got to explain it to you, you're worse off than I am. All right. Obviously, cybersecurity is no laughing matter, but especially for our industry. Cyber risk is one of the highest priorities for insurers, consumers, and regulators, and the problem is expected to grow in frequency and severity and complexity. To help our industry prepare for the growth in cyber risk, the NAIC members formed a cybersecurity task force in late 2014. We have 30 jurisdictions that are members of the task force. It's led by immediate past president Adam Hamm, commissioner from North Dakota. I am honored to be the vice chairman of that task force. The task force has a fairly aggressive work plan for 2015, and it involves coordination of various NAIC working groups dealing with all aspects of cybersecurity. The first task was to establish a set of guiding principles. We started by drafting a set of 18 guiding principles that were based on the Securities Industry and Financial Markets Association, SIFMA, their guiding principles. We released the first draft in mid-March, and after receiving a number of comments and a lot of written response, I can't tell you how encouraged we were to receive over 300 pages of written response that shows that the industry, the interested parties, and the regulators are extremely concerned about this issue. But then after receiving additional information, we pared the 18 draft principles down to a manageable set of 12 principles that were adopted April 16th, 2015. The guiding principles will serve as a foundation for protecting consumers' personally identifiable information and held by insurers and insurance producers, and to help guide the regulators who oversee the insurance industry. A copy of the guiding principles is on the NAIC website. Now that the principles have been adopted, the task force will begin to work on a consumer bill of rights. The Bill of Rights will cover statutes and regulations regarding security breach notification and will set the expectation for insurers in the event of a cybersecurity incident. Consumers have entrusted their personal, financial, and health information to insurers and health care providers, and they have a right to expect that this data is secure. Consumers also deserve to know when a breach occurs, that they can take steps to safeguard themselves against identity theft or other types of fraud, and to be advised on what steps to take when a breach occurs. Next, the task force is working with the Property and Casualty Committee of the NAIC, the C Committee, on a proposal to add a cybersecurity supplement to the annual property and casualty annual statement. After much discussion and suggestions from several states and a number of interested parties, the committee adopted the annual statement supplement to collect additional data regarding cybersecurity insurance. We did that last Friday, May the 15th. Further illustration that the task force is extremely busy. That proposal now goes to the Blanks Committee. The task force is also working with the IT Examination Working Group. The working group plans to review existing guidance and will be working with the task force on improvements to the examination protocols for state financial examiners to check cybersecurity capabilities of insurers. The working group will use the 12 guiding principles to ensure that the handbook guidance includes more robust information on cybersecurity. The working group expects to review the guidance at the NAIC summer national meeting in August. And the final guidance revisions will be effective for exams starting in 2016. Finally, the NAIC, as you know, maintains numerous model laws, regulations, and guidelines. Each of those that are related to cybersecurity are in the process of being reviewed and will be updated as appropriate. We will continue to monitor developments in the cybersecurity area. We'll advise and report and make recommendations to the executive committee as new developments occur. Thank you.
Thank you, Ray.
Well, good morning, and thank you so much for inviting me to participate in the panel and the conference. And thank you also to the NAIC, state insurance regulators, federal agencies, and international supervisors for your efforts on cybersecurity. The issue of cybersecurity is particularly important at a conference on international insurance issues. Many insurers operate in multiple jurisdictions, and a greater number of insurers outsource their data operations outside of the jurisdiction in which the consumer's personal information is collected. It's therefore essential for jurisdictions around the world to collaborate on the protection of personal consumer information that's collected and housed by insurers, and to encourage and assist insurers in the defense against cyber attacks. The protection of consumer personal information is only as strong as the weakest link. I'd like to start my brief opening comments by talking about insurers' use of big data. Insurers today collect and maintain far more personal consumer information in electronic format than even 5 years ago, let alone 15 years ago. In addition to insurers collecting far more granular data about their insureds' vehicles, and insureds' properties, insurers now obtain large amounts of non-insurance personal information from data brokers for marketing, underwriting, pricing, and claim settlement practices. Data brokers can provide information on consumer shopping, web browsing, government records, and more. The collection and use of much of these data by insurers is completely opaque to consumers. Consumers do not know what personal information is collected, what it's used for, and how long it's maintained. Consequently, consumers have limited ability to protect themselves from the loss of the data by the insurers at the same time that the potential damage from cyber theft is increased due to the significant growth in the volume and breadth of personal information collected by insurers. While some personal data have a limited shelf life, such as credit card numbers, other data have no shelf life and can be used to scam or harm consumers as long as they live or even beyond. A Social Security number or information on medical conditions can be used for many, many years. And the nature of the harm can be different from identity theft. For example, use of the data to target scams on vulnerable populations, such as elderly with specific medical conditions, promised a miracle cure. A year or two of monitoring of consumers' credit information will be inadequate assistance to consumers for losses of certain types of personal information. Consumers need greater understanding and control over the personal data collected and maintained by insurers. Clearly, some personal information is essential for insurers to operate, to sell and administer their policies. Other information, however, is not essential, and consumers should have the right to opt in to allow insurers to collect and house non-essential personal consumer information. Consumers also have the right to expect that regulators will require and insurers will implement safeguards as strong for personal consumer information as the safeguards for the monies that consumers pay insurers for premium. A regulator would not allow an insurer to operate if the insurer could not demonstrate an ability to account for and protect the funds collected by insurers from consumers. Personal consumer information is as valuable or more than the monies consumers give to insurers, and regulators should require strong minimum standards for data protection and data breach response. An insurer who is unable to meet these minimum standards should not be allowed to operate. Just as an insurer who could not account for and protect consumer funds would not be allowed to operate. The last point I'd like to open with is our hope that the market for cyber insurance thrives. Just as insurers have historically identified new risks for consumers and businesses and have developed products to meet these new risks and to help consumers reduce loss exposure, consumers and businesses. However, the promise of valuable personal cyber insurance products is not guaranteed. Broad regulatory guidance is necessary to ensure that new personal cyber insurance products have real value and are not misleading and do not provide illusory coverage. It's especially important at the dawn of a new era, and such broad regulatory guidance is consistent with promoting competition and protecting consumers. So I want to close these opening comments by again thanking Sharon and the rest of the NAIC for organizing this really important international issue. Thank you.
Well, I'll get up real quick. So Sharon hinted at the breach last night. My role at ACE, Tech Cyberline Product Manager for the what we'll refer to as affirmative coverage. So this is the actual coverage for and underwriting for the incidents. You know, the USA Today front page, I won't even show you what the front page is, but obviously it's a breach. In my shoes, 12:36 a.m. last night, get an alert, not that it's our insured, but simply a breach is hitting the news. So I live, breathe, and eat this. This is all I do. I love talking about it, and I think most importantly, it's interacting with various elements of insurance. So interacting with different product lines, interacting with regulators, sharing what information we do have, whether that's claims data, whether that's really threat data, you know, working with technology companies. But the key is awareness, and I think why we're here today from a panel setting is really just raise the awareness bar, talk through it as a group. We're open to questions, we want to interact. The more interaction we have, the more we achieve with cyber. It sounds scary. If you understand it, you start to understand it, you live it, you understand it more and more. That's really what we seek to accomplish with the panel today. With that, that's really all I had. Just invite questions.
Good morning, everyone. Very quickly, so I'm from the AMF in Quebec, province Eastern Canada, speaks French. So we're an integrated regulator, so we do securities, intermediaries, deposit-taking institutions, except banks, and of course, insurance. And just I think for this morning, we'll talk about cybersecurity, cyber risk. It's going to be a lot about IT, it's going to be about tools, risk management, but I think one message also that should be important is fair treatment of customer, protection of personal information, and conduct of business issues should also be taken into consideration when you talk about variety of risk, be it cyber risk or other more, I would say, traditional risks. So I think the IIS at the international level has done a great job on conduct of business. The members that have participated in the past in the market conduct working group that I had the privilege to chair for almost 4 years, and the financial crime task force also that is doing our work on cyber risk is going to be very important, and I think you'll hear from this morning's panelists that The U.S., what the U.S. is doing is going to be looked at by other jurisdictions. It's going to be looked at what we do in Quebec and in Canada, and I think also around the world. But also, as I said, conduct of business issues should not be forgotten when you talk about cyber risk. So I think I'll leave the floor to you and go for Q&As. Thank you.
Well, in keeping with that respect, to allow some time for questions, I've got a long line here, and I'm going to kind of keep my panelists on their toes, and I'm not going to ask them in the order that you probably have had them presented to you. So anyway, let's talk about the insurance industry. And I'd like some thoughts. Is there something about the insurance industry in and of itself that makes it attractive to hacking? Any thoughts?
Yeah, I think we have a tendency to overcomplicate the simplicity. When a risk manager or insurance company asks us questions, you know, what should I be concerned with? It's not that complicated of an answer. And ultimately, after a breach or before a breach, the key question is, what data do you have? I think insurance, clearly we have a lot of data, Birny referenced. It varies by the type of insurer, and it varies by the size of insurer. And clearly it varies by the protection of that data. So the key questions are, what data do you have? PHI, PII, payment card information, where is it within your network, and how is it protected? So that's the simple three questions and the most obvious. And I think as you get more granular, the how is it protected, and then also what are the policies that you have in place to make sure that employees understand that, and simplify it down to awareness and training to make sure that it's not something that's either sought by bad actors or exfiltrated by bad actors. So there is some granularity with the technology that we look into, but it really comes down to those three simple questions as far as the data and all the questions surrounding the data that we have. That's my.
So I guess I would say that I think financial service providers are likely to be more of a target than non-financial service providers for the simple reason that they really have a lot of personal consumer information. And to that extent, insurance companies may be more of a target just because they have a tremendous amount of personal consumer information, not just insurance related, which is a lot, but now a lot of non-insurance personal consumer information. So if you're looking to steal personal consumer information, you could go to the 7-Eleven where they have a little bit of money, or you could go to the bank where they have lots and lots of money. And I think to that extent, it's incumbent upon regulators to recognize sort of that kind of danger that insurance companies might pose because of the tremendous amount of information they possess.
I think that distinguishes our industry from the other industries, other breaches such as Target, Home Depot, and along those lines, because we do have so much personal information, health information. We're just a ripe target for a hacker to gain a whole lot of personal information. So I think we do have to be more diligent than other industries.
And I think oftentimes we forget that it's not just PHI, PII, payment card information. We as insurers have access to M&A documents before the M&A happens. We have access to financial statements. We have access to health information that may or may not be de-identified, re-identified, et cetera. And I think it's easy, and as we look at risks, it's fairly easy to tell when we ask questions on applications is really, you know, what do you have? That response can be very thorough, and it can also be very simple. So in line with kind of the simplicity, you know, there is a thorough understanding of what data you actually have and where is it in your network. I think if you ask various, you know, levels of an organization who's responsible, you know, when we give continuing education classes, the first question is just by title, you know, show me who's responsible for your organization's data. And no one raises their hand. And the obvious is that everyone should be raising your hand because we all interact with it. I think that's what we forget a lot is that the interaction on a user level and the amount of data that that really I see, you see on a daily basis is significant. And there's an element there that we've got to just accept that.
Well, the only thing I wanted to add is that I think insurers have a leg up because they've been in the data management business. I mean, that is essentially their business, is collecting data and monitoring and managing data. That's so integral to the policy administration and claim settlement process. If you look at some of the other types of businesses that have been attacked, they collect data, but they don't view themselves as a sort of a data management operation. So I think insurance companies have more experience with data management. So I think there's opportunities there to sort of hit state-of-the-art data protection more easily.
Yeah, I would say that, you know, picking up on Birny, I hope the question is not that it's attractive because they're not as well prepared as other financial institutions, but my answer would be no. But I think one thing that helps, and we've seen that in when we study what is done in the US, Europe, and in Canada, compared to the US, there is no obligation to disclose data breach yet, except in the province of Alberta. And federal level, provincial level, they're working on it, and we have to pick up on this a little bit more in Canada. But what we saw and what we understand, and maybe you'll have more answers than I have questions on that, but it's the fact that a requirement to disclose data breach usually brings better knowledge of data protection, et cetera. So there is also this little thing of compliance kick that I could say that would help. But honestly, I do hope it's not that, because they're not well prepared. And they do manage, and they do have a lot of data, health-related data especially, compared to other financial institutions. But that's something that in Canada, I think, we'll need to pick up a little bit more with regards to the legislative and regulatory framework.
Well, you know, in the United States, our breaches have been primarily with the health insurance line. And Julien, I don't know in Canada if you all have had breaches and if they, what lines of or types of insurance. So I guess the question would be, is do you all see that it is particularly health insurance is more attractive, or is it just Heffernan's, or could be in any line?
I would say health. Health would be the first one, but you know, I think it hits any kind of organization, even government. Organization, the last one we had was with the Canadian Revenue Agency with a heartbeat breach and social security numbers that were stolen, et cetera. But, I'd say that it's not only a question of this, but you also have in PNC UBI usage-based insurance, or what we call back home telematics, where it's not only personal information that you gather, but it's also the behavior of drivers that is collected, and which brings not only an IT or cyber risk question, but also a question of outsourcing risk, because usually all of these data is outsourced to a third party. And this is something that we have focused, and I know that our federal counterparts also are focusing on outsourcing risks, and that could bring with the collection of data. So I would say that would be primarily that on the PNC side, maybe more UBI, and the life side, of course, the health insurance and all the medical records that the insurers hold. So that would be my personal view on that.
I would just say that the perception of health insurance and health is it, maybe because of in the headlines, that's what's obligated to be notified. I do think, if we use law firms as a good example, over the last maybe 5 to 6 years, law firms were a common target for bad actors. Because they had such sensitive information. And I think, as that progresses and as they focus more of their time, they as in the bad actors, clearly if a confidential information or M&A document is discovered, there isn't necessarily that need to notify publicly, which I think changes the game a little bit. But I would say from what we've seen, healthcare information is clearly a focus in order to sell on the underground dark net. And that's really the bad actors versus just what we'll call insider mistakes or the obvious mistakes. And that's kind of what we're seeing of late, and you can see that in the headlines.
All right, Birny, y'all want anything?
Yeah.
Well then, okay, and going off that then, with the theft of health information, what do you think is the particular appeal on that? I mean, it's not obviously, I mean, what's, it doesn't immediately look like it's financial gain for those hacking. So what would be the appeal in recovering a large amount of health information, private health information?
So I'm assuming Birny has additional input on this. My sense is we haven't necessarily seen the implications of the healthcare information. On the dark net, and for those on the dark net, it's basically the Tor network where the black market is for this data. You know, fulls or full healthcare information can go for anywhere up to $250 per fulls, and fulls because it's a full record. Social, healthcare information, really who the health insurer is, but also diagnoses ups that number. So in some ways it's a short-term direct financial loss based on the personal gain of the bad actor. And then in other ways, I think we haven't necessarily seen what the end game is on fulls. So of that healthcare information and just.
I think Matt really covered it. The only thing I'd add is what, sort of repeat what I said earlier, which is that there's some data that have a short shelf life, like a credit card number. And there's other personal information that really has no shelf life, and that's a lot more valuable. And it's a lot more dangerous to the consumer if it's released. So if there's information about a medical condition, then that doesn't have a shelf life if it's a chronic condition that can be used to scam the consumer in one way or another for a long period of time. Same thing with a Social Security number. That's gold compared to a credit card number. So that's why it's not only essential to protect personal consumer information, but it's also important to give consumers the ability to say no to insurers collecting non-essential information. And to have that information destroyed after a certain period of time. There's no reason for some information to be maintained indefinitely. And I think that's an area for regulatory guidance, to be sure.
Well, let me get into some specific questions and put kind of each of you all on a spot. So I'll start with my good friend Ray Farmer. So can you briefly tell us, you know, what are we as regulators doing to monitor the data security of insurance companies? And, you know, what does that process look like?
Well, the industry looks to the state regulators to aid in identification of uniform standards and to promote accountability across the entire insurance sector and to provide essential information. The Cybersecurity Task Force came up with the guidelines, and those are intended to establish regulatory guidance that will aid in the protection of the consumer data, as well as provide notice to the consumer once a breach has occurred. One of the more important of those 12 guidelines is number four, the one that affirms that regulators want to be sure that the cybersecurity guidance for the industry is flexible, scalable, practical, but more important, it needs to be consistent and consistent with nationally recognized efforts such as those of the that are embodied in the National Institute of Standards and Technology, the NIST framework. That's an accepted framework that cuts across a number of industries, and it is one that the task force has chosen for consistency, but also the NAIC examination handbook is being examined to provide to be reviewed and provide more robust look at cybersecurity during the exam process.
Okay. Julien, what about in Canada? What steps are being taken there?
Well, I would say twofold. Firstly, in Canada and in Quebec in particular, we're a principles-based regulator. So our framework is through guidelines. It's not through specific rules, except for protection of personal information, which is dealt with another organization, a Commission for Protection of Personal Information. Same thing at the federal level. So it's not under the mandate of the regulator to, you know, enforce breaches of personal information, except with regards to breaches or non-compliance with our framework. So we have guidelines which are based on governance, compliance, and integrated risk management. And so what we're doing is through on-site inspection or off-site reporting, collecting data on cyber security information. What is coming is what we will be doing is we're working right now on a operational risk guideline which will have specific flavor with regards to cybersecurity. I know that that the federal level also, they are working on the same kind of guideline, and a colleague here, Jim Doherty, is in the room, so if you have any questions as to OSFI's work, since I'm not a OSFI representative, I would not want to say things that are not not correct or not exact, so you can ask Jim, he's in here. But in Quebec, that's what we're working on, and we'll be publishing or launching a survey or a questionnaire to all of the insurers that do business in the province to try to better understand what policies and procedures they have in place to better identify, assess, and mitigate cyber risk. So it's something that should be done by the end of this year or early next year. And of course, we've had some information. We had a questionnaire on conduct of business risk that was sent last year, and we were happy to see that out of the 8 different sections that we asked questions on, that came with, you know, our conduct of business guideline, which is based on ICP 19 from IIS. The protection of personal information had the highest score, and insurers had the best processes in place with regards to the protection of personal information. So that was good news, but you know, we still need to work on that, and that's what we plan to do in the next year or so.
So I wanted to applaud the efforts of the state insurance regulators for really paying more attention to these issues and focusing on it. But I guess what I'd like to do is I'd like to sort of frame this issue a little differently. If a consumer gives $100,000 to a life insurance company for a variable annuity, the regulator wouldn't say, well, we're going to develop guidelines for accounting and protecting that $100,000 that are flexible, scalable, and responsive to the size of the insurance company. You'd develop guidelines that say you have to protect those consumers' monies. I think it's really important to think about personal consumer information in the same way. It has value to the consumer in the same way or greater than monies that a consumer gives to an insurance company. And there really needs to be guidance that protects that in the same way that there's guidance to protect the money that a consumer gives to an insurance company. And I think that's really a good way to think about it.
Yeah, I think something encouraging. So the SEC guidance maybe 3-4 years ago on outlining cyber as a risk factor in a 10K, 10Q, only 3 years ago, now over 70% of publicly traded companies include that as a risk factor. I think that brings it to the ERM level, enterprise risk management. It brings it to the board level. It brings it to the audit committee. And I think over time, and that's only 3-4 years ago, I think over time, as that, you know, continue to go to simplicity and awareness, as that awareness grows at an enterprise level, you know, I do think it's important to understand kind of how the cybersecurity spend correlates with kind of the overall expense. And I think you're getting towards that. There's a case in Florida where the settlement was essentially based exactly on what Birny referenced, is basically how much it would have cost a company or the company to protect the actual data of their consumers, which is something that's fairly important as it relates to being an insurer of this. Because that is, you know, that is an element, and the plaintiff's bar is really approaching it that way: is how much would this have cost you in the situation of protecting it adequately? Which is also a question of, you know, what is adequate.
You know, that's a good segue. It's kind of interesting because not only has insurance companies in our case in the United States, been breached, we also have insurance that's going to be relied on to provide the protection. So let's kind of segue into that. And you mentioned the awareness. And, you know, the awareness is being heightened by, you know, front page, top of the fold stories that we have. But what are the, is the marketplace going to be there? It's how difficult is it for the business to secure an insurance policy? Is the capacity going to be there? And I guess I'm going to direct these first to you, Matt, to elaborate on. And what can we as regulators do to help provide and make sure that coverage is available to meet the needs? So if you don't mind, please.
It's a good question for with a room full of regulators. As you know, I think what's important, and I know this is probably the underwriting-like answer, but it is education. It's education of carriers, it's education of consumers, and it's education of, most importantly, or more importantly, brokers. So the broker community, I think, is realizing, okay, this is clearly a growth opportunity. Where are our avenues for education? I think as of today, the avenues for education is ultimately the carriers and obviously, you know, other brokers to educate kind of the marketplace, inclusive of regulators, you know, where the marketplace is, you know, whether it's language, whether it's kind of the rating methodology. And ultimately, I think where the big disconnect is the education on from a technology standpoint. So I think when people hear cyber, all of a sudden they glaze over and think that this is entirely technology. What we find is that it's actually just, it's risk management. And we, as the insurance community, are the ones educating the general public about cybersecurity from a risk management standpoint, because I think the technology community hasn't necessarily embraced that because it is more of a product approach. So what I think is encouraging is really that education process needs to be really a 360. It needs to be on the technology component. It needs to be on the insurance component. I think most importantly, from a regulator standpoint, and specifically an insurance regulator, is educating from a clarity standpoint the different lines of coverage. And I think that's where the marketplace will thrive. Fitch came out earlier this week with a report that, I'll paraphrase it, expects the industry, and this is specific to cyber insurance, but expects the industry to broaden coverage and accept larger and potentially more threatening exposures. And as an underwriter, you think to yourself, okay, is this accurate? And I think for the most part, it's immature enough to accept the fact that we don't have as much data that we do historically. I always use the analogy with fire insurance. And I came across an article written in 1906 that talked about the history of fire insurance and kind of how immature it was as it was evolving. And we were doing this basically to research the history of the word firewall, which is pretty ironic because firewall came from fire insurance. And I think what we realize is that if we really will grow, we need to adopt kind of the mitigation strategies. So instead of just risk transfer, it's got to be, let's educate on what the risk actually is. I think as an industry, we're focusing more on educating the broker community on why they would be buying the insurance and really what the threats are specific to that organization. If you want specific on capacity and that, we can get into it, but really I think the capacity and the growth is there. Almost 2.2 billion GWP at this point for the affirmative cyber coverages, but the clarity is important because there's a lot of what we'll call cyber that's written or underwritten that isn't necessarily the explicit cyber coverage that will respond in the way that the consumer thinks.
Well, I'll ask Ray then. Ray, do you have any statistics already on how the market's growing here in the United States?
And that's going to be the beauty of the cybersecurity data supplement that's going to be filed with the annual statement, and the first one of those will be filed in 2016 for this year's numbers. It is an immature and a growing market, but as best we can tell, as Matt said, it's about a $2 billion written premium industry right now. Mass majority of that's written in the United States. Best we can tell right now, there's been a survey, there's about 35 companies that are writing cyber as a standalone coverage. Many more are providing it as an endorsement. As a regulator, that number concerns me, the many more providing it as an endorsement. Was it merely an accommodation? Was it just an add-on to get the business? Did the carrier get an adequate and accurate premium for that increasingly high risk exposure? The market is growing. Numbers that we've seen indicate from the years of 2009 through 2014, it's growing at about 13%. But research also shows that the mid-market insureds and the smaller clients really are still in denial about whether they even need the coverage, and they think that they will not have a breach at all of any type. Trust me, it's not if, it's when each of us will be affected by a breach. So I think the data collection that the NAIC has initiated now will give us better numbers in the future as we go through this, as the marketplace itself matures.
Julien, let me ask you, and Bernie, I'll come back. What about the growth in Canada? Are you all seeing a lot of cyber?
Well, from what I read, it's been there since the 90s, but I think now, in the last years, it has grown. But as I said earlier, cyber insurance, what we understand, came from disclosure of data breaches. And, it exploded when the requirements came into place in the States and in other countries. We, as I said earlier, don't have that specifically in Canada, but the market is growing. We've got a couple of Canadian companies that do sell cyber insurance or cybersecurity insurance, and a few other foreign ones. The information is not readily available, so I don't have specific numbers as to. But it's something that is growing, but I think the aspect also that I would want to kick in with Matt's comments with regards to education, I think this is very important. If it's sold to retail customers, this type of insurance, is that it has to be drafted in a way that it is understood that the risk is the right product is sold to the right person, and this comes in with the conduct of business issues that I was talking earlier. It's not just a question of IT risk, it's a question of also having the right product and the right product packaged and manufactured so that when it's sold to retail, companies a bit different, but then again, this must not be between companies as a substitute or a replacement to the job that they have to do is to manage, assess, and mitigate this risk much better. Instead of just having cybersecurity insurance that would take care of everything and then not do their primary job properly.
Barney.
So I think the point I'd like to add is that I think education means a lot of things, but from the consumer perspective, education really means loss mitigation, instruction, and activity. So, the insurance industry has a long and fabulous history of promoting loss mitigation. Matt talked about, fire insurance, but if you look at things like Hartford steam boiler, the bulk of their premium goes to loss prevention, and then they insure the sort of the residual amount. And I think with cyber threats, there's a real potential for a similar type of insurance product that is primarily loss prevention with insurance to basically handle the residual risk. Because insurance companies can easily develop and have the expertise to work with commercial clients to help them reduce their risk dramatically. And that, to me, is a fundamental role of the insurance mechanism. On the consumer or personal side, I think it's even more important, because consumers really don't have an idea of what their exposure is, how to address it. So the opportunity for education and loss mitigation for individual consumers is even greater. And I think what's really important there is, for example, consumers need to understand that their exposure is much greater than identity theft. You know, so that products that inform and educate consumers will inevitably increase the market for those products.
Yeah, and I don't mean to, but the phrase, if not, it's not if but when, my least favorite phrase. I think, you know, what we need to focus more on is how is this happening and why is this happening? And you'll see a lot of the big markets, you know, including us, is essentially we've realized that. And if the market and continuing to grow in the right way, in the underwriting process in itself, if we're doing our job right, if there are unfavorable answers through the application process, we need to have some form of solution, or at least, you know, of answer. So if we're the ones educating on what the risks are, you know, that, I think, consumer or that policyholder needs to at least have an answer. And that's really where a lot of what the cyber marketplace is focused on right now. If you read, you know, various headlines, the bigger markets are really focusing and turning a lot of our efforts into loss mitigation, because we need to be able to answer the question of what should I be worried about, instead of just taking risk on, because that is not the way, you know, underwriting started, and it's not the way underwriting should be. Is really, let's avoid the risk instead of waiting for it to happen and having the right incident response.
Well, I think there was one clear point that we can all agree on. There is a tremendous need for us as regulators, for consumer groups, for the industry themselves, just to raise the awareness and educate our consumers. And I know I've incorporated that in a lot of discussions, you know, pointing out to my agents, it's not only a product to sell, but you need to look at your own agency and then, you know, what data that you have. So that, I think that is going to be a challenge for all of us in this room, is just trying to make people aware of the possibilities. And then, as Matt said, you know, we have to delve down into how it's happening and how we can prevent it. So I don't know if this was your plan, but since I'm the first panel, you know, I'm going to maybe set the pattern here. We've got a few minutes. Are there questions from the audience? I think that, you know, we've got some experts up here that might be able to pass along, and I've got some spotlights. So if you've got a question, just, you know, please, there's a mic, or, mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Doug.
The gentleman back here on Doug. The right, and then we have down in the front on the second row next. Yes, sir.
Hello, good morning. This is Jan Germain from the European Commission. I had a question about, since it is an international forum, about the difference in culture we have about data protection between the US and the EU. There is an ongoing debate in the EU about data protection. So how do you see ways to cooperate at global level about data protection, particularly with data that are stored in the insurance sector, so that we achieve convergence? Thank you.
I think as of today, a lot of what's driving the European cyber market and cyber as the, you know, the dedicated cyber coverage is business interruption and the first party coverages versus the liability and the notification, because the notification element really isn't there. I do think, though, that we, you know, and our group essentially works with our European peers, is basically understand what's happening in Europe from a first party perspective. Can tell us a lot of what's happening or what should be happening in the US from a first party perspective. What we've also found is that the hackers, and I've referred to them as bad actors, but bad actors is probably better, is they'll test out various malware in Europe, and this is specific to retail, before they test it out in the US and actually use it. So we can actually learn a lot from what's happening in Europe and historically what is going to be happening in the US. To use to use retail as a good example, and obviously retail in the news from a affirmative standpoint, but EMV, so chip and pin chip technology, chip and signature technology for credit cards, was implemented in Europe in the early 2000s. And what we saw there and what we understood there, we can actually apply now to the US base because of the EMV liability shift that happens in October of this year, where the fraud will ultimately be owned by the merchant or the issuing bank. So I think it's important that as we look at this, and from a regulatory standpoint too, we understand that there are clear cultural differences, and we've got a Canadian team too, and I oftentimes, right, wrong, or indifferent, always associate because they are close neighbors. You know, it couldn't be that different, but we do accept the fact it is far different culturally. And primarily liability-wise, what's nice is tech is not all that different. So the granular technical understandings are not drastically different, so we can do a lot there. But that's just, I guess.
Yeah,
well, on the regulator side, I would say that, it's what happens around the globe is of importance, and to get the best practices that are in place within different jurisdictions. And that the IIS, the Financial Crime Task Force, has conducted a survey early in 2015 on combating cyber crime and on cybersecurity, and the analysis is ongoing right now. We had a meeting last week here in DC of the Financial Crime Task Force, and a small group there were analyzing the results, and the goal is to have an issues paper with regards to the best practices around different jurisdictions. But what we can see, and I don't want to give anything right now because it has to go through proper channels, but I see Yoshi is there, so I don't want to go over technical or the secretariat here at the IIS, but I think there are differences in culture, but I think the risk is the same all around, but you've got different ways of assessing and mitigating it. So I think it's going to be very interesting what the IIS is doing, and also at the IOSCO level, they are doing the same thing, a task force that is chaired by my CEO at the AMF in Quebec, and they're doing exactly the same work that IIS is doing, is to try to pick up the best practices that you have in different jurisdictions. So as regulators, it's something that we need to take a look at.
Well, I would just offer that I think one opportunity for convergence would be to develop a set of consumer rights regarding the protection of personal consumer information. I think those can be distilled to a handful of basic rights, and those can guide sort of common responses to aid convergence.
Well, I think that's the importance of the NAIC Cyber Task Force in developing our next project, the Consumer Bill of Rights, going back to the educational piece, and just showing how global the entire subject is, but we need to drill it all down to the how it affects the consumers themselves, and show them what happens in a breach, what their next steps are, and as regulators, I think our job is to walk them through that.
Thank you, Commissioner. My name is Doug Barnard from Barnard Global, and my question was partially answered by the last set of responses with respect to international, but the what wasn't addressed was whether there's been any discussion in Asia, and I noticed that the panel didn't have any, and we're active in APEC, the Asia Pacific Economic Cooperation effort, and with various companies and industry members, and regulators, we're working in an industry effort to come up with answers and dialogue on some of these issues. So we would just reach out to you and say to please bring in the Asian discussions, whether through APEC or the Business Advisory Committee or the APEC Financial Forum or the Insurance and Retirement Income Workstream, chairman of who's Okubo, Mac, is here, and talk to them about getting them involved in this process. I'm concerned that there is, it almost sounds like a let a thousand flowers bloom strategy. And so there's all this activity going on, and I would hope an organization, perhaps like the Financial Stability Board or somebody, could kind of put a little rope around it and get IOSCO and NAIC and the IIS and all this activity coordinated. Otherwise, you're going to have just a tremendous amount of draw on company resources, on commissioner resources, to participate in each one of these different efforts. And the worst thing that could happen is that there's 1,000 different solutions and we all have to participate in them and with no real answers. So I would just hope that, number one, you include the Asian dialogue in your discussion, and number two, to have some kind of a coordinating body. And I think the FSB is probably the best one, and they're probably doing it too. So I, you know, maybe we can bring that to the attention of the group sometime in the next 48 hours as to exactly what's going on there. Thank you.
And I'm going to take that as a
statement.
As a statement, not a question at that point. We've got time for.
I would just, you know, it's also a growing market. You know, there's conferences in Hong Kong. We and other carriers have a team in Australia, in Asia Pac. That are focused on cyber. So I do think it's important to understand that you know, APAC is definitely a place in which the interest is growing, and it should be growing for clear reasons.
Okay. All right. I've got two hands, so we can have two quick questions, and then we might have just abbreviated responses. So, sir.
Hello, it's Rob Aston. I just want to ask a question as a consumer. One of the things that's horrified me in reading about data breaches is that apparently much sensitive information is in plain text. Hackers get in and get at plain text of sensitive information. It's not even hashed. It's not encrypted. How much can we do to solve that part of the problem? How much more needs to be done there just to start off the process of getting greater security?
I'm of the opinion that the regulation is going to become more proactive. So a lot of what the regulation is right now is all reactive. So you have a breach, respond to it the right way, you have a set time frame, and I'm probably oversimplifying this. But I think a good example, Massachusetts, the Written Information Security Program, is essentially healthcare-based information. You need to have a plan in place, and that's proactive. That's essentially, you know, what if it's not in every application, it likely should be. But basically, it's accepting of the fact that if you have healthcare information and you have Massachusetts consumers, you need to have a Written Information Security Program. Encryption, you also mentioned, I mean, those are what we who live this know are very, very relevant and important, but I think the general public doesn't understand that. The importance of encrypting at rest, in transit, you know, on mobile devices, it's easy, but it's also simple, and it's the awareness piece. We're oftentimes the one telling the risk manager that they have unfavorable issues, and that's the first time they're talking to the CIO or the CISO. And that's what we see as valuable. So once that conversation happens with whoever's making the insurance decision, with whoever's on the technology side that can make that decision, you know, it still comes to the basics. You know, encrypt devices, have a plan, and if part of your plan and defense in depth and layers is insurance, then that is part of your plan. It's not the plan.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'd just add that there seems to be some low-hanging fruit in terms of stopping some of the damage from identity, from data breaches. And so I think that insurance regulators have a role in sort of, first of all, sort of prompting some thinking about this on the part of insurers. And insurance companies have a tremendous potential to prompt that kind of thinking for all sorts of businesses in the sale of the product.
And Kevin told me we had a few more minutes than what I thought, so.
There was one in the back there.
Okay, I've got one in the front, and then some, and a lady in the back. There's two ladies here in the back. So if you want to come here, come to the front, and then we can go back. And I'm sorry for doing this. Those lights are rather bright.
Hello,
I feel
good
like
morning.
I'm on Broadway.
Yoshikawa from IIF. Just comment on Julien and also Doug's comment for international coordination in this area and your comment that proactively regulators take action. First, yes, as Julien mentioned, in IIS, we have a specific work stream to take care of this work, and issues paper will be issued hopefully soon. So we are watching all that. And globally, not only insurance, IIS, but also you mentioned Julien IOSCO in security global organization, as well as banking, Basel committee, and payment system organization. Four of us are working together on this issue. But it's still very emerging stage, and very much shortage of experts and expertise in the insurance front or regulatory front. As I can understand that the industry front also they are looking carefully, but ours also we need more sort of people who understand this issue. But coordination is emerging, not only insurance globally, but globally regulatory front, but also different sector or regulatory sectors around the world. Thank you.
We have the back. And I guess as we're taking the microphone, and ma'am, if you'll hold your hand up again here in the back, you know, that, yes, she made a good point. As regulators, we're not IT experts either. So you all have to realize that I think with our market conduct working group that is looking into some of the data breaches with the companies, the first thing that we had to do is to bring on board a data IT specialist, because we just do not have that level of expertise. And it's so we're playing a lot of catch up, and we're playing in a reactive role here, and hopefully we can get to that proactive role. But that's one of our biggest challenges, and I think that goes across the globe, that just because you're a regulator does not mean. Now, I don't know, Ray might be an IT expert with all his iPad. I'm going to get him one of those work belts, you know, that you see construction people wear that have all the different pockets, so maybe he'll be able to.
I will tell you that I've become more of an expert than I wanted to, because in our state, 3 years ago, our Department of Revenue was breached. All of our tax filers for years 1998 to 2012 had their information affected. So as a state, we have spent millions upon millions and had a cyber expert come in and do a vulnerability assessment of every agency. And we're becoming cyber experts more than we ever wanted to. I have one set meeting on my schedule every Monday morning at 8 o'clock. It's with my cybersecurity officer in my agency, a former FBI guy, that we go through what has happened during the week and how we're doing with our new protocols that we've established to address cybersecurity issues. But our state has learned early and the hard way.
If I might, and also just to pick up the work that has been going on with, you know, at the regulators, is also raises awareness on other risks that cyber risks brings. And I talked about outsourcing, and it's something that back in Quebec we're I wouldn't say worried, but it's something that we're looking at a little bit more closely. Because what we realize, as I said earlier, in PNC insurance or UBI, the data is usually what the three major insurers that sell UBI products in the province, they do outsource their data collection to a third party. And what we find is that, as you said earlier, the question of expertise found within regulators to be able to better assess, but the same thing inside insurers with regards to due diligence and good due diligence that needs to be done, and to make sure that the service provider that the insurer does business with knows what he's doing, but to know what he's doing, the insurer needs to know what he's outsourcing, and us as regulators, as you said, need to also have a level of expertise. So it's an emerging risk, but we are realizing that it's not just a question, as I said earlier, of IT tools and processes. It's outsourcing, it's conduct of business, culture of fair treatment of customer that needs to be implemented within insurers. So it might start with cyber, but it's evolving in many other risks that we're realizing we need to work on.
So I just want to reinforce that this is really a critical international issue, mm-hmm. because you know, an insurance company that operates in multiple jurisdictions, you know, you can have great cyber protection in the U.S., but if in one jurisdiction you have weak cyber protection, then that doesn't really help. Similarly, if you outsource and use third-party vendors and there's access from a third-party vendor to that personal consumer information, again, that outsourcing is in, say, outside the country, and you as a regulator have limited ability within your jurisdiction to monitor what goes on something that's outsourced outside of the country, there's a critical need for international cooperation and international work on these issues.
Now, I know that, Yoshi, it's probably top of the agenda, or if it's not there, it's moving in that direction. So, and did we get the mic to the back of the room?
Yes, if I could just, Diana Keegan from MetLife. Thank you very much. I'll be very quick because I realize we're getting close to time. It's really sort of a follow-on from a lot of the comments and questions we've heard here about doing business internationally. And I think one thing, we take the protection of data obviously extremely seriously. We take in a lot, as all the insurance in the room do, of very personal and confidential data from people, and understand greatly the need to protect it. But I think to some of the comments that have been raised before mine, we're seeing a proliferation of different rules around the globe, meaning that we have to comply with separate rules in different jurisdictions, which is fine until you come to the point of efficiency for your consumers. And the next generation of younger generation will want everything on an app, will want everything electronically. So we sort of, I can't make it, I think the bottom line, the consistency, so that there's a reasonable cooperation and a reasonable level of consistency such that we can continue to move data and be able to provide the services that consumers want. Because yes, consumers want protection, but on the other hand, they also want something right now, fast and efficiently. So, mm-hmm. You know, it's I think to Yoshi Kawai's comments, it's very encouraging to hear that the IIS is working on some standards that could be put in place as best practices for regulators around the world to follow. Thank you.
Well, I think, were there any other questions? I didn't see it. Well, I think we've all got challenges, you know, ahead of us, and we're all in the same situation, and but we have the same goal, whether we're consumers or we're the industry or we're regulators, and, you know, it's just an effort. We got a lot of good people working on it. Would you all please join me in thanking our guests and panelists today? And I think Kevin is going to give us a break. Okay, but he's got to officially come up and give us a break. So.
I got to officially thank Commissioner Clark for her wonderful job moderating the panel. We thank the panel. We are going to take about a 15-minute break. I would ask that you be back by about 25 minutes after. We're going to start promptly at 12:30. Oh, excuse me.
10:30.
So without a script, I really can't do this. So be back promptly so we can start. The next session is going to be on group supervision. We got a great panel, and it should be an exciting time, and we want to allow them as much time as possible. So enjoy your 17-minute break. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
I think some of his personal information has been stolen.
Burning.